Good morning. Welcome to St. Charles. Today we're celebrating the seventh Sunday in Ordinary Time. Before we begin our celebration, please take a moment and make sure that your cell phones are turned to silent or off. Thank you. Our opening song today is Gather Us, Lord. It's number 97 in your Choose Christ book, 9-7. Please stand and take a moment to welcome one another.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. May the love of God, the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you. My dear brothers and sisters, we do gather today in the Lord's presence to offer our time of prayer and communal worship. As we begin our praise this day, let us call to mind those moments in this last week when we have not been the loving people we are called to be, and seek God's mercy and forgiveness. I confess to Almighty God, and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us all our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Amen. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Glory to God in the heart.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that always pondering spiritual things, we may carry out in both word and deed that which is pleasing to you. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Leviticus. The Lord said to Moses, "Speak to the whole Israelite community and tell them, 'Be holy, for I, the Lord, your God, am holy. You shall not bear hatred for your brother or sister in your heart, though you may have to reprove your fellow citizen. Do not incur sin because of him. Take no revenge and cherish no grudge against any of your people. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. I am the Lord." The word of the Lord.
The Lord. A reading from the first letter of St. Paul to the Corinthians. Brothers and sisters, do you not know that you are the temple of God, and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy that person. For the temple of God, which you are, is holy. Let no one deceive himself. If any among you considers himself wise in this age, let him become a fool, so as to become wise. For the wisdom of this world is foolishness in the eyes of God. For it is written, God catches the wise in their own ruses. And again, the Lord knows the thoughts of the wise, that they are vain. So let no one boast about human beings, for everything belongs to you, Paul or Apollos or Cephas, or the world, or life, or death, or the present, or the future. All belong to you, and you to Christ, and Christ to God. The word of the Lord.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus said to his disciples, "You have heard that it was said, an eye for an eye, and a tooth for a tooth. But I say to you, offer no resistance to one who is evil. When someone strikes you on your right cheek, turn the other one as well. If anyone wants to go to law with you over your tunic, hand over your cloak as well. Should anyone press you into service for 1 mile, go for 2 miles. Give to the one who asks of you, and do not turn your back on one who wants to borrow. You have heard that it was said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies, and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your heavenly Father, for he makes his sun rise on the bad and the good, and causes rain to fall on the just and the unjust. For if you love those who love you, what recompense will you have? Do not the tax collectors do the same? And if you greet your brothers only, what is unusual about that? Do not the pagans do the same? So be perfect, just as your heavenly Father is perfect." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Wow. In one sense, this gospel today needs no explanation, needs no homily, needs no cultural background or interpretation of Greek or Latin or Aramaic words to understand it. It's pretty straightforward. When someone strikes you on your right cheek, turn the other one. If someone wants to go law over your tunic, give them your cloak. If they want to go 1 mile, go with them 2 miles. Love your enemies. Pray for those who persecute you. Now, there's no doubt, there's stuff that we could start to like pull out of this and pull it apart and look at it in detail, but I think to do that would cause us to maybe lose the thrust of what Christ is trying to say would give us some place to hide or lessen the impact of this amazing gospel that really is, I think, the cutting edge of what Christianity is about. Love your enemies. It's just that it seems so impossible to do. So impossible to do. Has God asked us to do something that's not possible? I think it was June 17 of 2015, and you may remember this story. There were 9 members of the Emmanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church in Charleston, South Carolina, who gathered together for their weekly prayer and Bible study. They were gathered in the basement of their church when a young 21-year-old white guy dressed in jeans and a t-shirt wandered in. And what did those 9 people do? They invited this guy to join them. And for a while he did. He sat down and participated in their Bible study. And when they got to the end of the study and they all bowed their heads to close in prayer, he pulled a gun from his backpack and killed all 9 of them. He was a self-proclaimed white supremacist. You may remember that. I have no idea, and I don't think I can really begin to imagine what the families of those 9 individuals experienced. Hopefully I never will. Hopefully none of us ever will know that. To have someone taken so quickly, so unexpectedly, so violently, so hatefully from you for no good reason at all. The anguish, the grief, the pain, the loss that those families must have experienced. What didn't get quite as much coverage on the news was this. Was 3 days later, just 3 days later, at the bond hearing for the shooter, several members of those families turned to the young man who had committed the crime and said, "I forgive you." Where does that come from? How do you do that? Or closer to home, several years ago, my father and I were on a retreat up at San Damiano in Danville. And one day we sat at a table for lunch with a lady who shared her story with us, that her adult son had been shot, cold-blooded, brutally murdered. They caught the guy who did it. He was tried and convicted and was sent to San Quentin. And she had gone to San Quentin to meet him and to tell him, "I forgive you." And beyond that, even though members of her family decided not to talk with her over it because they couldn't, they just separated herself from it, she continued to go regularly to San Quentin to visit the man who had murdered her son, to get to know him and understand him and give him a chance to know her and understand her. Where does that come from? Where does that come from? Today, in our first reading, God has Moses gather all the Israelites, a word for everybody, and he has him say to them, "Speak to the whole Israelite community and tell them, 'Be holy, for I, the Lord your God, am holy. You shall not bear hatred for your brother or sister in your heart. Take no revenge and cherish no grudge against any of your people. You shall love your neighbor as yourself.'" And of course, for Israel, neighbor was other Israelites. Centuries later, though, Jesus is going to take that someplace else when he says, as we heard today, "Love your enemies." Love your enemies. Love those who think differently than you. Love those who live differently than you. Love those who oppose you. Love those who are outside of your group. Love your enemies. In reality, I think what God is asking the Israelites to do, to be holy, and what Jesus is telling us to do, to be perfect, is nothing less than what God did for us. To paraphrase Paul in Romans chapter 5, he says that God loved us even when we were, Paul's phrase, God's enemies. And he reconciled us through the death of his Son. What's so challenging about this command to love your enemies is that there are no exceptions. It's not love your enemies except. Jesus doesn't go there. It's not love your enemies except the boss who passed you over for promotion. It's not love your enemies except the head of the committee that never listens to your ideas. It's not love your enemies except your sibling who's taking more than his or her fair share of the inheritance. It's not love your enemies except the neighbor who doesn't take care of their yard so it looks a mess and they're always noisy. It's not love your enemies except your best friend who betrayed you after years of friendship. It's not love your enemies except your ex-spouse, that idiot. It's not love your enemies except the person who stole your credit card number, ran up an entire bill. It's not love your enemies except the guy who broke into your house and took your stuff. It's not love your enemies except the guy who shot your family member. It's not love your enemies except. When I was doing my research for today, I found a reflection on the gospel that was written 3 years ago. Bear this in mind, 3 years ago, by a lady named Paige Byrne Shortle. And she writes this 3 years ago. Some folks may be fortunate enough not to have close to home enemies. When they hear this gospel, they may think of the enemies of our nation. For some, the enemy is our current president and his administration. For some, it's those who voted for the other guy. For some, the enemy is those who criticize the church. For others, it's the bishop or pastor. For some, it's black people or white people, rich people or poor people, refugees who are trying to get into our country, or citizens who are trying to keep them out. But whoever it is, we tend to think that my enemy is the exception, that my hate is reasonable and is somehow not included in what Jesus was talking about. We rationalize why it's okay for me to wish poor upon or bad upon or hate or dislike this person because it's reasonable. But Father, what about no exceptions? Just as God's love has no exceptions, so we are called to have no exceptions. Mercy calls us to go beyond the reasonable demands of love. The Christian love that we are called to live is not some kind of contract or fair bargain agreement with other people that we will love you back only as much as you love us. Because our love as Christians, as followers of Jesus, as those who strive to be holy as God is holy, who loved his enemies, our call is not to react to being loved or not being loved. Our call is to love regardless. It is to come out of who we are as God's people, as Christ followers, as disciples. It's supposed to be sort of the ground of our being, that we almost don't have another way to act. I mean, look at Jesus. Look at his life. Even when the agenda was against him, and they were out to kill him, he never opted for anything but the supreme value of loving. Not because he thought it was going to change people. Not because he thought it was going to suddenly make them his friends. No. He did it because he was so rooted in who he was in God that there was no other way to be but to love. And that's what we're called to strive after. We're used to trying to get results. Well, maybe if I care enough for this person or love enough this person, they'll change. That's not what we're about. If that happens, wonderful. Maybe we'll help resolve some of the problems of the world. But we're called to love even when our enemies don't change. That's what we're called to strive after. I know, it sounds impossible. And yet, there are 9 families in Charleston, South Carolina, and 1 woman in Danville who shows me that at least from time to time, it can happen. There are moments when we can be holy, when we can be perfect as God is perfect, when our love can be given without any bounds. I invite forward at this time those members of our community who are preparing to receive the great sacraments of initiation at the Vigil of Easter. My dear brothers and sister, we send you forth to reflect more deeply upon the word of God that you've heard proclaimed this day. Know as you go forth that we hold you in prayer, and we eagerly await the day that you join us in full communion here around the altar of the Lord. Go now in peace. As one community of faith, let us rise to profess what we believe. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Trusting in God's unending love for us, we bring before him our needs in prayer on this holy day.
That by serving with love even those hostile to its message, the church may imitate the God who sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all nations may begin to live as children of one God, taking no vengeance for past wrongs and seeking peace for all people. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That we may heal those alienated from the church by seeking their forgiveness for past hurts. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That our assembly may go the extra mile, serving the wider community without conditions or expectations, always seeking to be holy as God is holy. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That all who in this world were temples of God's indwelling Spirit may now rejoice to belong to God for all eternity, especially Kathleen Ryan, for whom this Mass is offered. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
for all the intentions written in this book of intercessions and all those we hold in the silence of our hearts. We prayed to the Lord.
Good and gracious God, hear the prayers your people bring before you this day. Grant us all things for your glory and for our salvation, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Our song for the preparation of the gifts is Come Holy Spirit, song 105 in your Choose Christ book, song 105.
Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. As we celebrate your mysteries, O Lord, with the observance that is your due, we humbly ask you that what we offer to the honor of your majesty may profit us for salvation through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Father most holy, through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your Word through whom you made all things, whom you sent as our Savior and Redeemer, incarnate by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin. Fulfilling your will and gaining for you a holy people, he stretched out his hands as he endured his passion so as to break the bonds of death and manifest the resurrection. And so with the angels and all the saints, we declare your glory as with one voice we acclaim. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the font of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread, and giving thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and blood of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis, our Pope, and Michael, our Bishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection and all who have died in your mercy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her most blessed spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him and with him and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation,
but deliver us.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, you who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
And may the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you always.
Amen. Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say,
Our first song for communion is Restless, song 167 in your Choose Christ book. 1, 6, 7.
The keeper of my heart.
Please join in singing Fill Me, O God, Song 96, 9, 6.
Let us pray. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that we may experience the effects of the salvation which is pledged to us by these mysteries, through Christ our Lord. Amen. And please be seated for a few announcements today. If you didn't notice the poster on the stand by the picture of the Holy Spirit and the table that's there, you'll be delighted to know that the Bishop's annual appeal is back. Yay, get excited. It comes every February, and I was telling the other masses, I've got it up here if you wanted to see it. They sent me a 30-page manual of all the things we're supposed to do to make the Bishop's appeal work in this community. And I went, don't need that, because I just trust you guys and your stewardship. I mean, like this is technically kickoff weekend for the appeal. Next weekend is education weekend for the appeal. Then it's commitment weekend for the appeal. Then it's follow-up weekend for the appeal. And then it's second follow-up weekend for the appeal. But that's all laid out. We're supposed to have guest speakers who give testimony to why the appeal is so good. But Our parish goal is exactly the same as it was last year, which is $35,486.03. And someone gave me the 3 cents last night, so we're on our way. But last year, you just blew the doors off this. So I just trust this to your usual good sense of stewardship and care. As you know, and if you don't, I'm going to tell you now, the Bishop's Appeal covers 7 particular areas that are funded through the appeal. There are areas of ministry that no single parish in the diocese could do, so they fall under the bishop's office. The bishop oversees them, so it's the bishop's appeal, and all the parishes contribute to it to make that happen. If you've given to the bishop's appeal before, you should have received in the mail already, I know I got mine, a letter from the bishop, one of the pamphlets, and an envelope to make a pledge this year. If not, there are plenty of pamphlets on the back table that describe the appeal. As a matter of fact, I think they sent me enough pamphlets that I could give one to every house in Livermore. I've got boxes of them. So please take one or 20 if you would like and read up on what the appeal is. The envelopes are there as well, because in 2 weekends, on commitment weekend, we will have a collection for the appeal. They've actually asked me, and I think it makes sense, not to call it a second collection, because with the second collection, people think, oh, I put in 20 bucks, I'm done, it's over. What they're looking for are basically pledges, commitments, 10-month pledges that you'll pay off throughout the remainder months of this year at, you know, 10 or 20 or 30 bucks a month, whatever it is. As I say, our goal is a little over $35,000, and you figure there's a little over 1,000 families in the parish. It's pretty reasonable that we can reach that goal. So I commend that to you. And if we don't reach that goal, then I'll break out the 30-page manual and figure out how we hard sell the thing. But otherwise, I just trust it to you. In about a week and a half, Ash Wednesday is here. Ash Wednesday is Wednesday, March 1. On Ash Wednesday, we will have the following services. 6:30 in the morning and 12:15 in the afternoon will be communion services with the distribution of ashes. And in between there, at 9 a.m. and 7 p.m., we will have Mass with the distribution of ashes. For the 9 a.m., 12:15, and 7 o'clock in the evening, we need ministers. If you're an acolyte, if you're a lector, if you're a hospitality minister, all that kind of thing, we need your help for those masses. So there are sign-up sheets on the table by the half wall in the back there. Thank you for that. Wanted to highlight for you that the Grief Ministry of St. Charles and St. Michael's is going to host a St. Patrick's Day dinner this year. They do it every year, actually. It's wonderful. It'll be about a month from now on Saturday, March 18, 6 o'clock in our hall. It's $12 a person. It's corned beef and cabbage and all the everything Irish you can imagine. It's a great fun evening. The food is really good. The only way to get tickets, though, is through the mail. So the Knights of Columbus are outside today with the flyers. You can pick up one of those, fill it out, mail it in. I understand they're limited to about 100 people, so you want to get your ticket requests in soon because it sells out every year. And like I say, it's really a lovely evening for St. Patrick's Day. And then I did want to mention to you again about the last day of this month, the 28th, which is actually Fat Tuesday or Mardi Gras. That on that evening from 6 to 9, we're having a party over in our hall to celebrate Kate and to thank her for her 6 years as director of music ministry here at St. Charles. Next weekend, Kate will actually be with me and about 50 parishioners at the Religious Education Conference in Los Angeles. So this is her last Mass leading us in music as director of music ministry. Restless, I was getting choked up. I could hardly give out communion. So thank you for that. But after 6 years, we're going to thank her and celebrate her and bless her and do all sorts of stuff for her on Mardi Gras. 6 to 9 in the evening, we will provide all the wine and drinks and all the hors d'oeuvres. We just ask you to show up, celebrate Mardi Gras, and thank Kate for 6 amazing years of ministry here at St. Charles. So thank you, Kate. Yeah. So we'll have some fun that night. Outside of that, as always, just a warm welcome to any guests or visitors who might be here today with us. Thank you for joining us on this Sunday afternoon. As a community of prayer, we know our worship before God is made just all the more beautiful for every member of the body of Christ who joins us. If you're maybe new to Livermore and looking for a parish to join, we have a welcome table out back with a minister who can answer questions for you about the parish or even register you in the parish today if you'd like to do that. So again, thank you all for your presence, and please know that you're always welcome here at St. Charles. And the Lord is with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Our Mass is ended. Let us go forth glorifying the Lord by our lives.
Our closing song is going to be Just Like You. It's song number 48 in your Choose Christ book, 4-8.